Welcome to Christ for Life. We are so excited today to have Clark Van Gilder, professor, and also a PhD in learning theory. Clark, thank you so much for joining us on Christ for Life, talking about reaching millennials. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Glad to be here.
One of the things I'm really excited about this morning as we're on this topic of reaching that next generation, the millennials, is I've known Clark Van Gilder for a number of years. He's a Bible teacher, and he's really passionate about reaching the next generation for Jesus Christ. So one of the things that I've been thinking about is the relationship between Paul and Timothy. And so going deeper into this idea beyond the first century church, but how did that first generation of believers disciple the second generation of believers, go from Paul to Timothy? We're thinking in our day how to keep kids in the church. They didn't even have church buildings. So clearly there was something going on that allowed that second generation of believers to not only stay strong in the faith, but to grow the church. And so, Clark, that idea of relationship between one generation and the next, would you be able to just enlighten us in some way on that? Because I know that's something that you've been looking deeply into, and your view on that is going to be critical to our viewers.
Yeah, I think that the example of how Paul shifted the way that church worked, the way that relationships inside of the church worked, is probably as good example of how you shake the world in a radically different way. So the Barna data is pretty clear on why young people stay and why they leave. And one of the number one reason why they stay in church instead of two out of three of them, which is the current walk away rate, which is pretty startling, is to make room for meaningful relationships. But what that means is a different, I want to use the word worldview, but it's very hard to be too narrow about what the word worldview means. And really, it's just a framework of ideas and beliefs. And for the Christian, it's that we look through that lens, you call it a Christian worldview, a biblical worldview, and we interpret everything that way. But we also interpret the world that's around us through our education, the books we read, the movies we watch, the music. I mean, our worldview is shaped by so many things, and that's because as learners, there's a way that we learn, and social habitats are easily, at least in the research, the richest habitats for learning. It doesn't matter what you're learning, physics, art, it doesn't matter, learns for really always been that way. But what's been different is, say, the generation that we grew up in as Gen Xers, the shift. And so we went away from a culture where the church was relevant. During our lifetime is the shift away from the church being relevant in the culture at large, to it being irrelevant, which I think is where we're at today, generally speaking. And the reason and the ways in which we learned. When we were kids, you could crack the whip of excellence over our heads and we would march.
That's right.
And it doesn't work that way anymore. And I think that probably the short answer, I mean, we could talk for hours and days in the Barna data, but mentoring is really the key relationship change. And I would venture to say that most of us has never been mentored. And I mean, in a mentoring, I like to use the example because I like kung fu movies, even though they're kind of cheesy at times, but they always have the same storyline, roughly. This kid or person gets beat up, or their whole village is destroyed by the bad guys, so they find a master and they devote their whole life to learning in relationship with that master. And we don't do that kind of thing anymore. The last time people did that was probably the time of Christ, maybe for a century or two later, but that has gone away. Real disciple, we think a class where we lecture and fill in blanks is discipleship. And that might be part of the puzzle, but if that's the main event, it's no better than a lecture. And lectures are the worst way to learn. Lectures work when they're shared interest and shared expertise. Almost nobody has expertise because it takes at least a decade to obtain it. So I think the huge shift is there is a worldview shift. And I say that carefully. I'm not saying shift away from a biblical worldview, but probably focus it better than we have, realizing there are other things that are in that focusing puzzle. And just because they're not the Bible doesn't mean they're illegitimate or wrong. It just means they have to be factored in. So I would pause there maybe and see what's next.
Well, I think that's an interesting thought, because if we go to Timothy, and we know that his father was a Greek Gentile, that Timothy was not circumcised as was the custom for Jewish boys at the time. He wasn't circumcised as a boy. His mother was Jewish, but his father was a Gentile. And so here you have this young man, and some would argue that his father probably had passed away or was out of the scene by the time Paul meets him. And so you have this young man, kind of, you know, today we have the term of unchurched. He was probably unsynagogued, right? Because his mother was Jewish, but again, he wasn't circumcised. So probably there wasn't a strong connection for him in the synagogue. His mother would have had that. But here he is kind of unsynagogued. But yet he becomes, well, the Timothy that we know and that we love. And we see the writings of Paul through 1st and 2nd Timothy, how he's building him up in the faith, and that building on the mentoring relationship that you mentioned, that mentoring relationship. So maybe there's something in there that it's not going to be one of these, hey, let's just go have a pizza party and have a program for our youth, but more, we've got to intentionally mentor them and disciple them. That seems to be a challenge for the older guys to mentor the younger guys. Why is it so difficult?
I think I'm glad you and the intentionality of it. And I think that one of the subtle things that we miss is the authority that drives what we learn and what we even consider worthy of learning. So it's a pretty well studied thing. And if someone were to look up research on personal epistemology, there's a 40 plus year research trajectory on personal epistemologies. And interestingly, some of the leading researchers in that are physics professors. It's
interesting.
And conceptual change. They've merged a little bit together in the end. But so as an authority source, so a person might be your authority source, a book such as the Bible or whatever, your friends, the in-group. There are so many authority sources, and sometimes those authority sources are restrictive and negatively so, and sometimes they're liberating. They allow you to take in truth in all of its forms and be what Dallas Willard, I recommend Dr. Dallas, well, he's dead now, but he was a Christian philosopher, and he has a podcast on being a morally responsible skeptic. That's a whole nother. And he was chewing out Christians mainly in his thing, but it applies to everybody. But authority. And so what are some things that impact someone's learning? Your personal epistemology about what counts as authority. Your self-efficacy. Can I do this? Am I authorized to do this? So it ties in with your authority. But the intentionality that guys like you and I and anybody that's in spiritual leadership needs to think about is, my goal is not to deliver information. My goal is to shift what a psychologist, an educational psychologist, would call the locus of control for learning from me to the student or the mentee. So teaching versus mentoring. Teaching, unfortunately, is more about lecturing, even though that's the least effective way to deliver knowledge, unless there's shared interest and shared expertise. Okay, so I could go to a physics conference. I'm interested. I have expertise. I could learn. You could go to political science or history. You're interested. You're skilled. You could learn. The rest of us, you know, what it all depends on the individual. But that, I like the Andy Griffith model. He was a pro, and he was a fictional character. Okay, he knew how to not just, no, that's wrong. Stop it. Go to your room. He knew how to walk that path and weave a lesson into an experience. And it was always relational. He never sacrificed the time to take that time and make the lesson relational and let people fall in ways that they could handle. Obviously, I wouldn't just, you know, let everything go.
And maybe therein lies the key, is it's not just so much that we need to have the older generation get into the life of the younger person that they're discipling. But if I think about Paul and Andy Griffith, as you mentioned, it's also about letting the mentee be in the life of the mentor, to let the mentee watch how the mentor is living his life, because Timothy watched Paul live his life. So it's not just the mentor saying, I'm going to get into your life. It's the mentor saying to the mentee, and oh, by the way, you can come into my life. I'm going to let you into my world. I'm going to let you see my thought processes, because that's how we're really going to build a discipleship relationship, is not by just inserting ourselves into the next generation's life, but to say to them, you can watch us live our life, so that iron is sharpening iron.
One quick example that I do in my introductory physics classes is I start the course in an entirely unconventional way. And one of the things that I let students do is write many essays, and they get full credit for just telling me what they think about that topic. And it takes a little bit of time, but not too long, a week or so, before they realize I'm really getting paid to just tell him what I think. This is awesome. And so it breeds an excitement for the learning. It's one of many little steps that are deployed to get them to change the way they approach learning, because generally speaking, they come unprepared to learn. Nobody knows how to learn anymore, it seems. They know how to memorize. They know how to try to memorize. Very few people are good at it. And so it's stuff like that. There's a lot to learn, and we probably need to mentor our mentors in just the educational psychology of what it means to learn these days, because the younger generations approach that from an entirely different framework than we do or our parents did. Totally different.
Yeah, I love the metaphor. So if we take iron sharpening iron, mentoring is not, let's say, a butter knife cutting into butter, because the butter is not sharpening the butter knife. That's like a bad model of mentoring. That's where the mentor says, I'm in charge and you just do as I say, not as I do, kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. But true discipleship, mentoring is iron sharpening iron. It's the two blades coming together and sharpening each other. So with that kind of thought, my last thought from you is, what would you say to a parent or a pastor or a youth leader or someone who wants to mentor another person? What would you say to them to get started in building that iron sharpening iron relationship?
That's a tough question. I would say watch Andy Griffith show, take notes. But I say that, that's funny, but it's true. I don't know if they were trying to do that, but man, did they do that. In fact, I remember coming to that late and thinking, gosh, I wish I would have seen this when I first had kids. I needed to take a few lessons. But it's about pausing to not give the answer and asking questions that invite an answer and reward an answer, even if it's wrong. And of course, how wrong it is depends on what kind of reward you give. But it's fundamentally changing the relationship and letting multiple ways of representing an idea. So for instance, if you really want to learn something, you need to fire up multiple regions of the brain at the same time on one thing. And so like word, symbols, pictures. So getting people to write and say, draw, dance, sculpt, whatever is appropriate, or even within that, you know, what if you have a kid with a special talent or a special interest? Get them to use that representational system to express their ideas. It values them, and it invites them to be the other blade that sharpens. In fact, one of the things that I've gotten from this over the years with my students in physics is they will say stuff that I learn from, and I'll turn around and tell them, hey, this is a brilliant idea. I'm going to pretend I thought of it next year when it's a new batch. That happens probably at least several times a semester. There'll be something that a student wrote or said or asked, and I'm like, that's amazing. I wouldn't have thought of that. And those things really pay off. If you can, but you have to set up the environment where that can be a regularity. And that's the chore, is there's a lot to learn. There's a lot under that hood of how to change the dynamic of learning. Expertise is hard to obtain. It takes 10 or more years of regular reflective practice. So I think a lot of people think that expertise can be memorized or obtained from memorizing. And there is no short path to expertise. It doesn't have anything to do with your intelligence, natural ability. Expertise is always obtained by 10 or more years of reflective practice. And that's also a 30-year research.
Yeah.
Huge.
So it's not about a lecture, it's about a conversation.
Long conversation.
So that's where we're going to jump into that relationship building, that mentorship, that discipleship, not by lecturing, not by one-way communication, but a two-way dialogue, a conversation between mentor and mentee, like Paul and Timothy.
Yeah, exactly.
Amen. Amen. Well, Dr. Van Gilder, thank you so much for your time today. We're going to look forward to more sessions on reaching millennials. Thank you so much.
All right. You're welcome. Awesome.
All right, God bless you.